Hey, this is Mike from All That Remains, and you're watching MPJ.
Now close it, stop to move on. Just one last time and I'm gone. Keep telling myself that it's under control, and that's a lie I tell myself. I return to the scene of the crime, and I gather my pride. Still I know you're free, though you're not in terms.
Hi, it's
Nadine
from MusicianPhotoJournal, and
I'm
here with Heather and Mike from All Remains. Welcome back.
Thanks for having me again.
We saw you with the Buck Cherry tour there a few months back, and a lot has happened since then. My goodness.
Yeah.
I think it was like a week later. You guys were in Australia and then Japan, which all the craziness that happened.
Yeah, that was pretty. Yeah. That was fun.
Was that the first night? Because you guys only had two shows there, right?
Yeah, we had a day off. We got there. We had a night off. Everybody went out to dinner. Then we played a show the next night. And then we only had two shows. The first show was fine, and the second show, we got to the second show when we were sound checking, that's when the world started shaking.
Yeah, that's pretty crazy. Well, we're glad you guys made it out okay.
Yeah.
I know you guys were doing your stuff, and Phil did some reporting on it and stuff too, but...
Yeah, he came running to my hotel room at 3 a.m. He's like, I'm gonna be on CNN! I was all excited.
Aww. Had you ever had to experience an earthquake before?
No. I was told that we have, but like I've slept through them. Like in San Francisco one time, I guess we were in one, but it was like really in the middle of the night and I slept right through it. But that was real, like real, real. It sucked.
Well, you're from Massachusetts too, so it's not like we have that many earthquakes in this area or anything.
Yeah, I'm not accustomed. We've been like a magnet for natural disasters lately. I don't know what it is. We just drove through a tornado like a week and a half ago, like through a tornado.
Wow, where were you?
Where were we? We're driving to Minnesota. So where were we? We played like Indiana to like Minnesota. I don't know. I slept through that too.
Oh, no.
Floods, tornado. A tornado just hit my hometown in Springfield, which never happens in our area. So that wiped out so much stuff. It's weird. It's just been like so many natural disasters like right next to me lately. It's getting old.
Oh no,
but you're just sleeping through it all.
So. I'm sleeping or I'm just like narrowly avoiding all of them, thankfully. So I've seen the people that get really affected by it. You know, I didn't lose my house or nothing, so that's good.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
But on a good part, you guys got back here safe, and then you guys went out with Black Label Society for a little bit.
Yeah.
It was probably a pretty cool tour. Was you guys in the, Hourcast.
That was fun. Zach Wilde's been on my label for my whole life, so
I didn't want to.
It doesn't suck. Touring with one of your guitar heroes. And we are in Australia with Slash, which is my super like ultimate guitar hero. I would never get to meet him and take a picture with him. That made my life. I can die now. I'm perfectly happy.
And last time we saw you, said how you met Sebastian Bach, which was another one.
Yeah, I actually went out to dinner with him a few weeks ago.
Oh, how awesome.
He was filming something in Massachusetts, and he was like, oh, and I was like, yeah, I'll be around Boston. And he was like, oh, yeah, you know, I picked him up at his hotel. We went to TGI Fridays. So I was like, yeah, I'm having dinner with Sebastian Bach. This is awesome. I got his phone number now. I think that's pretty cool.
Aww. So despite all the natural disasters and craziness, buying, you know, good stuff.
Lots of good stuff. This whole cycle, we started touring on this album in September of last year. Mm-hmm. This whole cycle has been awesome. All the tours have been great. All the people have been great. Shows, amazing. The album was, you know, being received really well. So you kind of can't really ask for anything more. And we didn't die yet.
Oh, no. How was the Download Festival in the UK? I remember before you were really excited about doing that. You've never done it before.
Yeah, the first time. We did the main stage too, which was intimidating. We were sitting the second band that day at like noon. But there's still, man, there's probably still 20,000 people in there at noon watching. So that was cool. The best show of the whole tour, maybe of our whole lives, was Metal Town in Gothenburg, Sweden. We played with At the Gates and Soilwork. There was 25,000 people. It was the most unbelievable thing I've ever seen in my life. That was like, we all came on stage and we were like, yeah, that was the best show.
Why was it so amazing? Was it the crowd that made it so good?
The crowd in Gothenburg. Ever since we started going there, I don't know what it is. It's just when you grow up listening to all those Swedish bands, you kind of get like a thing in your head of what it's, like, it's supposed to be like over there, and it is. When you're younger and you haven't toured anywhere, you like you think a lot of these places that you go to are gonna be like, and like sometimes you're just really disappointed.
Yeah.
But Gothenburg is not like that. You go there and it's like exactly what you expect. These people running an interview. No, you can't.
And we talked about all these great shows and festivals and things. And of course tonight we're catching out with Hollywood Undead.
Yeah.
How's the tour been going so far?
Awesome. A totally different crowd for us, which is cool. It's like all 14-year-old girls. So weird. But the shows are mobbed. They're such big shows. It's really cool. And we've known those guys for 2 years now. We did some festivals with them 2 years ago in America and Europe. And then we kind of just did all the same stuff 2 years later. Like this year we went and did all the April radio festivals with them. And now this tour happened. When they presented the idea for the tour right away, we were like, yeah, that's going to be a good idea. Because we weren't doing any like American festivals. So.
I think we actually caught you guys the radio station in our area, Syracuse. Actually, the K-Rock band, you guys were there with them.
Yeah, was that this year?
This is last summer.
Last summer? Oh, yeah. That's one of the few shows we did all. We didn't do any shows.
Yeah, like you guys, I think we're off and recording and we came out.
But for 9 months, we didn't do any shows. That was one of a handful of shows that we did. That was cool, too.
Yeah, I remember you guys did one of the new songs. It was like the first taste that we got.
Everyone stared at us like we were aliens.
No.
One of those radio shows where they have two songs on the radio, so the people go nuts for those two songs. Everything else we play, they're just like, oh, that's a lot of screaming.
But you guys love it, because like we saw you last time with like Buck Cherry and them, which are more radio-friendly bands that were on that bill.
You got a lot of funny looks.
Yeah, you guys came out and freaking just slammed it, you know, with like, you didn't pull any punches.
Oh, we did that on purpose.
Yeah, it was
awesome. We put all the heaviest songs into the set on that tour on purpose just to make people cry. There's the same thing happening on this tour. Like we got a High Road to Hero. I don't even know how you say their name yet. They've only been on like two shows. But they're like a rap kind of band. So they go on. You know, Hollywood Dead obviously kind of has that like just like a hip hop thing happening.
Yeah.
So we kind of go on right in the middle, and like we go on, like all of a sudden like six pits open up. And you see all these girls. I've seen like little girls in tears already on this tour. Just like they don't know what to do. They're just getting smashed all over the floor. I'm just like. Yeah. That's what we're here for. Thank you.
Do some of them tosh bits.
Yeah.
Right?
We always do that. If we're on a tour with like a lighter band and people are like, we don't go, oh, this is a lighter crowd, let's soften set up. We make it heavier on purpose because it makes us laugh. So we just do it on purpose. We did it with Black Label, we did it with Hollywood Undead, we did it with Buck Cherry. Just make it heavier than better. People just kind of like, ooh. We love those books, even if it's negative.
Well, I love it too, and the Buck Cherry show, because I'd see you guys split them and had them do a circle pit too, and some of the kids, like, there was the older women that were there for, like, Buck Cherry or whatever, just kind of looking like, what is this?
I saw an old lady in Illinois get her head cracked open from crowd surfers while we were playing. And she was like, her head was bleeding, and she was so pissed off. She sat there in the front row and just glared at us the whole time. As soon as I knew she was like, okay, I was
right.
Like, obviously, like, her brains were falling out. But, I don't know, I love it. I think it's fun when we scare people. It's great. Imagine if like a real death metal band was on tour.
Oh, I know, right? Or like, it's a really extreme.
Yeah, put camera torch on these shows.
The new album, again, is Premier Manny. His single and video is The Last Time. And actually, the last time that we talked to you, you were talking about the video and the making of it in Chicago. And now we have to actually see the final part, because I don't think you had even seen it at that point.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool how it came out. I liked all the wing things and the owl. I like the best.
I don't understand video at all. we read the treatments, and then you shoot it, you know, for 12 hours. Which is just miserable, completely miserable. And then you see it after you just go, oh, I don't know what any of this means. And that's it. I have no idea what that video means. It makes no sense to me at all. But music videos to me are just such a shot thing for now. MTV doesn't play music videos anymore. So your label basically has to just dish out a bunch of cash to pay for this video, and then you gotta recoup it. So you're basically just wasting money at this point, because the video just goes on to YouTube. It's like, okay, yeah, you got YouTube views. That's it. Even when it got played on TV, it was great. I just think, not that, like, I'm sure video guys that do music videos don't see this interview and go, wow, he's an asshole. But I just do the concept of the music video at this point, to me personally, is the most pointless thing in music right now. Like, check out this video on the internet.
The culture has changed. I mean, yeah, with the downloading just, and the, yeah, cheers. It's not like it used to be.
Why go
But down? It has switched too, like, because it was like on YouTube and stuff. Yeah. Like, people like on Facebook will start like, hey, check out this band I just saw, check out that book, and then they can plug through the videos. And
yeah, it's good they have something. Too. It's something, but, man, why dump $30,000 into it that we just end up having to pay back that it just doesn't get any use?
Yeah, it's a lot. And the hours that go into shooting them.
Music videos and full-length albums. No point to them anymore.
And full-length albums?
Yeah, I don't see the point. Not only the attention spans these days completely shot to hell. Nobody even wants to hear a full-length album. They just go buy two of their favorite songs on iTunes and don't pay attention to the rest of the album. When we play, like, deeper tracks from any album, you can tell, like, the vibe dies. So it's just like, it's weird. You get, like, you put an album out with 12 or 13 songs, you release three singles, only three songs that people know. You have your diehards that know every song, which is cool, which is great, but it's weird to work so hard on albums now. Because we really, like, when we all sit down and do it, we're like, everybody works really hard on every song.
Right.
And it's so funny to see 10 of them instantly go to waste. You put the record out and just go, oh, is that the one with the, you know, that's on the radio? No, oh, yeah, I don't know that song. And it's, okay, it's done. Yeah. Full-length albums. I saw Tommy Lee posted something about it online the other day. The concept of the full-length albums, pretty much, it hurts to write that many songs and have nobody pay attention to them.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, I know that one. It's on the radio. That's it. It's like, I'm gonna throw that music videos out the window to me personally.
It's unfortunate because I know that, like, you buy the CD or the vinyl, and the first you would like the one catchy song, but then since you had it, you keep listening to it. And I just remember, like, you get into the other songs because you had the whole album. So it's true, like, something I know that a lot of bands, like, a lot of albums I would buy, it was like the first time I listened to it through, I would be into that end of the other songs, and then when you have it, you keep listening to it, then, like, other tracks you wouldn't have thought of become your favorite. So
yeah,
or sometimes you're listening to it and the one song will pop right out and it's what you relate to and you're just like, this is the best freaking song ever. Yeah, no one sometimes ever hears it if it doesn't become a single.
Yeah. I'm old, I still listen to full albums, I still buy them too, and I just like,
with this album though, what I thought was pretty wild was that you guys put out a vinyl, and it's not the first vinyl that was put out. Right?
No, I know This Darkened Heart we have on vinyl, like Overcome was on vinyl. I don't think I remember ever seeing any Fall of Ideals on vinyl, which is dumb because that's like so many of our fans' favorite albums, the Fall of Ideals. I don't know why it never got released on vinyl. Or if it did, I'm just completely unprepared. Yeah, I don't know. People are starting to buy those again lately. It's just, you know, collector stuff. And
yeah.
I don't know who actually listens to them, but I think it's more like, if I'm standing at the merch table, a lot of kids will buy them just to have a sign or whatever.
Yeah.
Which is cool.
Yeah.
Like, I would do the same thing. If I buy a vinyl, I only own a couple.
Uh-huh.
Like, I just keep them in the wrapper, so I don't even open them.
Right. Or if you do, it's like you want to see the artwork at its fullest and see it in that big.
Yeah, like, I have Appetite for Destruction on vinyl, just because it's Appetite for Destruction.
Right.
I ain't going to listen to it on a record player. I'm not a hippie.
I think they actually have them now where you plug them into your computer so you can still listen to them.
Yeah, vinyl. Probably. I know Jeannie, our bass player, listens to vinyl because she's a hippie. So she loves going to old record stores and like finding weird vinyl bands you would never think any human being would actually listen to. And finds them and puts them, I don't know how she knows a record player. But yeah, she still listens to them, but I don't. I would just, if I would buy, just for collectability.
Yeah. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
It's great catching up again with you. Everything's happened since the last talk to you, and good luck with everything. And the Hollywood Undead tour runs into another month or so.
Hollywood Undead goes till, August. Well, for us, it's August 13th. The Hollywood Undead shows end, and then we do a few more shows. Mm-hmm. We're done August 13th.
And then what?
A little break in September. And there's a tour that we're doing in the fall that I already know about that I don't know if I'm supposed to say anything. But I've already seen flyers for it at places, so I would imagine I can say something. So I'm just going to say it.
All right.
But we're going, it's us, Hatebreed, and Five Finger Death Punch.
Oh, nice.
And it's long. it's October 16th at Christmas. So that's what I know about that.